The city of Toronto, Canada, is closely identified with the sport of professional hockey. The Hockey Hall of Fame is located downtown, and the city's long-standing NHL team, the Toronto Maple Leafs, play not far away at the Air Canada Centre. The first professional hockey team in the area was the Toronto Professional Hockey Club, also called the Torontos. They started play in December 1906, and after playing exhibition and challenge games, became a founding member of the Ontario Professional Hockey League. The Torontos played for the Stanley Cup in 1908, but lost to the Montreal Wanderers. The team disbanded the following year. At around the same time as the Torontos folded, the National Hockey Association was created, with teams in Quebec and Ontario playing for the O'Brien Cup, including the Toronto Tecumsehs. In December 1912, the Tecumsehs played their first game in the new Arena Gardens in Toronto. The Tecumsehs finished that season in last place in the NHA and was subsequently sold. They operated as the Toronto Ontarios in the 1913-1914 season, and the following season were renamed the Toronto Shamrocks. The Shamrocks operated for just 1 year. Another Toronto team in the NHA was the Toronto Blue Shirts, founded in 1911, who also played home games at Arena Gardens. In the 1913-14 season, the Blue Shirts defeated the Victoria Aristocrats from the Pacific Coast Hockey League to become Stanley Cup champions. After the 1914-15 season, the Blue Shirts absorbed players from the Shamrocks to fill out their roster after several players left to play in the Pacific Coast League. As we noted in the NHL history video here on Post to Post, Eddie Livingstone's maneuverings to engineer teams in the Toronto hockey market incurred the wrath of other owners in the NHA, and without the ability to kick Livingstone out of the league, they left the NHA themselves and formed the National Hockey League, today's NHL. The Blue Shirts were eventually allowed to enter that league after cutting their ties with Livingstone. The team changed names to reflect the new ownership and were called the Toronto Arenas for a while. Some fans continued to call them the Blue Shirts as well. The Toronto Arenas played its first NHL game on 19 December 1917 at Arena Gardens. In 1918, the Toronto Arenas won the NHL's first Stanley Cup against the Pacific Coast Hockey League's Vancouver Millionaires. The next season, the team took a year off, but returned for the 1919-20 season under a new name, the Toronto St. Patricks, also known as the St. Pats. The team was hoping, with the new name, that it would draw more interest from Toronto's large Irish community. The Toronto St. Pats won the Stanley Cup once again from the Vancouver Millionaires in 1922. In 1927, the team fell on hard financial times, but were rescued by an investor named Con Smythe, who purchased the team. Smythe had just finished building the New York Rangers team and had been let go by the Rangers when Lester Patrick was hired. The first thing Con Smythe did as new owner was change the team's name from the St. Patricks to the Toronto Maple Leafs. There are differing stories about why Smythe chose the Maple Leafs. One story is that Smythe, a military man, adopted the name in honor of the Maple Leaf Regiment. Another says he was inspired by the name of a minor league team in East Toronto that he had scouted. The new Toronto Maple Leafs played their first game in 1928 and missed the playoffs in their first year of operation. The following year, however, the Leafs made the playoffs and beat Detroit in the first round before falling to the New York Rangers. As the 1930s began, Conn Smythe decided to move the Leafs to a new, larger venue. Maple Leaf Gardens was built on the corner of Carlton and Church Streets in only 5 months in 1931 and became the home of the Leafs until early 1999, a total of just over 67 years. The Leafs got a new addition to the team in 1931, and that was head coach Dick Irvin. Irvin had been a star player and the previous year had coached the Chicago Blackhawks to the Stanley Cup Finals. He started with the Leafs in November of 1931 and took the Leafs to the Cup Finals in his first year with the team. The Leafs would get their revenge on the Rangers in 1932 when they swept New York to win their first championship carrying the Leafs' name. Leading the way in those playoffs was the Kid Line of Buschard Jackson, Charlie Conacher, and Joe Primo. Primo was the old man on the line at the age of 23. Jackson and Conacher were only 18 when they started on the line. The line was still quite young when they won that cup in 1932. During the 1930s, the Leafs also began to draw a national following in Canada thanks to the magic of radio. Foster Hewitt, who eventually did Hockey Night in Canada radio broadcasts for 40 years, was on hand for opening night at Maple Leaf Gardens in November 1931 and had conceived the idea for the installation of a broadcasting gondola suspended high in the arena. From that gondola, Hewitt broadcast to fans in Canada, the United States, and Newfoundland, which until 1949 was not a part of Canada. With his son Bill Hewitt working both radio and television into the early 1980s, the Hewitts were synonymous with broadcast of the Toronto Maple Leafs. When the Air Canada Centre was built to replace Maple Leaf Gardens, the new broadcast platform was named after Foster Hewitt. Here's Bob Cole working a game from high up among the rafters of ACC. Back in the Maple Leaf Gardens era in the 1930s, the Leafs made it to the finals 7 times but didn't win any more cups. During this period, they developed new players that became legendary in the city: Ace Bailey, King Clancy, Sil Apps, Gordy Drillin, and goaltender Turk Broda. In 1942, 10 years after their previous cup win, the favored Leafs were down 3-0 in the final against the Detroit Red Wings, but then won 4 straight games to be one of the few teams to ever recover from a 3-game deficit. Many teams were short players because of World War II, and the Leafs were no exception. Sil Apps and Turk Broda left to fight in the war. In 1945, still depleted by the war effort, the Toronto Maple Leafs eliminated the favored Montreal Canadiens in the first round of the playoffs in 6 games. They then met the Detroit Red Wings in the final. Though Toronto took an early 3-0 lead in games, Detroit won the next 3 to tie the series and force Game 7. Toronto won that 7th game for their 3rd Stanley Cup. In the 1946-47 season, with players back from the war, Toronto beat the Canadiens in 6 games to win their 4th Stanley Cup, the first of a run of 3 consecutive Stanley Cup championships, beating Detroit in the finals in 1948 and 1949. In 1950, the Red Wings got a measure of revenge when they beat the Leafs in 7 games in the first round and then went on to defeat the New York Rangers in the Stanley Cup final. Toronto's return to the Cup final was against the Montreal Canadiens in 1951. Former Kid Line member Joe Primo from 20 years earlier was now the Leafs' head coach. Despite orders from Coach Primo to stay put in his position, defenseman Bill Barilko rushed into the offense and scored the winning goal in overtime, beating the Canadiens 3-2 and winning the series 4-1. It was the Leafs' 4th Stanley Cup in 5 years. Bill Barilko was immortalized in a song by the Tragically Hip called 50 Mission Cap, which told the story of him going on a summer fishing trip in 1951 after winning the Stanley Cup and never returning. For the entire time he was missing, the Leafs were unable to win a Stanley Cup until the year his body was discovered in 1962. Barilko had died in a plane crash near Timmins, Ontario, 11 years earlier. The 1962 Cup win was the first of several under coach Punch Imlach. The team's ownership situation changed as well in that era, with Conn Smythe stepping back and selling his majority shares in Maple Leaf Gardens to a group of 3 executives, including his son Stafford Smythe, John Bassett, and Toronto Marlies president Harold Ballard. The Leafs of the early 1960s were truly a dynasty, with the likes of Frank Mahovlich, Red Kelly, Johnny Bower, Dave Keon, Andy Bathgate, and Tim Horton. They won Stanley Cups in 62, 63, 64, and their 13th overall cup in 67. But that is when the Leafs' luck ran out, and it hasn't been back since. Many fans attribute the Leafs' decline in the expansion area to owner Harold Ballard. When Stafford Smythe died in 1972, Ballard bought his shares and became the majority owner of Maple Leaf Gardens and the team itself. Not long after getting control of the Leafs, Ballard was convicted of tax evasion, fraud, and theft, and spent a year in jail. Once back in charge, Ballard decided to focus on making money rather than pleasing the fans. He let good players go and limited the team payroll, knowing that loyal Leaf fans would keep buying tickets and filling the gardens. Despite Ballard, Toronto still iced its share of very good and well-loved players, such as Darryl Sittler, Lanny McDonald, Tiger Williams, Ian Turnbull, and Boreas Salming. In the 1970s, some of the Leafs players stood out for their individual excellence. In February 1976, Darryl Sittler scored 6 goals and had 4 assists against Boston to set an NHL single-game record that still stands today over 40 years later. 1 year after that, Toronto defenseman Ian Turnbull became the first player in NHL history to score 5 goals on 5 shots. Ballard's antics appeared again in the 1978-79 season when he suddenly fired coach Roger Nielsen, only to rehire him before the team's next game because he couldn't find a replacement. After the Leafs bowed out in the playoffs, Ballard fired Nielsen again. At that point, Ballard rehired old coach Punch Imlach to run the team, but Imlach didn't get on well with the players, and the Leafs' performance showed. When Lanny McDonald was traded in 1979, angry Leafs players trashed the team's dressing room, and Captain Darryl Sittler cut the C off his jersey before a game in protest. Sittler himself was eventually traded away to Philadelphia. Throughout the 1980s, the Leafs were one of the poorest performing teams in the NHL. They backed into the playoffs occasionally, even with losing records, but made early exits when they did. During the decade, Ballard went through 3 general managers and 7 head coaches. The one bright light about such a poor performance in the standings was the higher draft picks the Leafs could access. But even after drafting early, Toronto would still not meet the salary expectations of many new arrivals, and they ended up moving off to other teams. One drafted player that did manage to stay with the Leafs for the long term was Wendell Clark from the WHL's Saskatoon Blades. Drafted in 1985, Wendell Clark went on to become one of the most popular players in team history and served as Leafs captain. With Clark, the Leafs went a little deeper into the postseason, making it to the second round in 1986 and 1987, and the first round in 1988. However, in 1989, the Leafs missed the playoffs entirely. Interestingly, 1989 was the year that the Calgary Flames beat the Montreal Canadiens for their first and only Stanley Cup win. A key figure in that cup-winning game was Lanny McDonald, whom Harold Ballard had drummed out of Toronto 10 years earlier. McDonald scored the go-ahead goal in Game 6 and carried the Stanley Cup around the Montreal Forum ice after what turned out to be his last game in the NHL. On April 11, 1990, Harold Ballard died, bringing an end to almost 2 decades of embarrassment and torture for loyal Leafs fans. Supermarket magnate Steve Stavro bought the team and hired new general manager Cliff Fletcher, who had piloted those cup-winning Calgary Flames to victory. Fletcher quickly made a 7-player trade with the Edmonton Oilers that brought goaltender Grant Fuhr and winger Glenn Anderson to the Leafs. He also swung a 10-player trade with the Calgary Flames for Gary Lehman. In return, the Leafs got Doug Gilmour and Jamie McCown. Fletcher also hired former Canadiens coach Pat Burns to lead the Leafs. Grant Fuhr shuffled off to Buffalo, and the Leafs put Felix Potvin between the pipes. The Leafs finished the 1992-93 season in third place with 99 points and made it to the third round of the 1993 playoffs. Although they eventually lost to Wayne Gretzky's Los Angeles Kings in 7 games, it was the furthest the Leafs had gone since their last cup in 1967. Before the start of the 1994-95 season, Fletcher traded captain Wendell Clark for Swedish center Mats Sundin, who went on to become captain in his own right. Coach Burns was fired, and Doug Gilmour, who had twice led the team to the third round of the playoffs, was traded to New Jersey. Cliff Fletcher was eventually let go by the Leafs after the team was unable to repeat their success of the mid-90s. The 1990s drew to a close with Pat Quinn as the new coach, Curtis Joseph in goal, and a new rink to play in. The Leafs played their last game at Maple Leaf Gardens on 13 February 1999, and a week later played their first game at the new Air Canada Centre. That year, they took a trip to the Stanley Cup semifinals, but were beaten by the Buffalo Sabres. The team reached the second round of the playoffs in both 2000 and 2001, losing to the New Jersey Devils both years. In 2002, the Leafs lost in the Eastern Conference Finals in 6 games. Curtis Joseph left for the Red Wings. Although Doug Gilmour returned to the Leafs, he sustained a bad knee injury and retired at the end of the 2003 season. In 2004, the Leafs set a franchise record for points and finished second in the Northeast. However, after defeating Ottawa in another round of the Battle of Ontario, the Leafs fell to the Flyers in six games. After that, the Leafs failed to qualify for the playoffs for seven consecutive seasons. Matt Sundin left as a free agent in 2008 and signed with Vancouver. Arriving in Toronto to the general manager's position in November 2008 was Brian Burke, who had come in from the Anaheim Ducks. Burke traded first-round draft choices in the 2010 and 2011 entry drafts for Phil Kessel from the Boston Bruins. Even with Kessel, the Leafs finished second to last in the 2009-2010 season. Not long after the 2012 season began, the Leafs fired Brian Burke and replaced him with assistant GM Dave Nonis. Under Nonis and new coach Randy Carlyle, the Leafs made it to the playoffs. It was during Game 7 against the Boston Bruins that the Leafs were victims of one of the biggest collapses in hockey memory, leading 4-1 with less than 15 minutes remaining in the third period. The error-prone Leafs let Boston back into the game and ended regulation time tied 4-4. Boston won the game in overtime, eliminating Toronto from the playoffs. After the following year, in which they failed to make the playoffs, the Maple Leafs hired the NHL's former head of player safety, Brendan Shanahan, to become the club's president of hockey operations. After taking a wait-and-see approach during the 2014-15 season, Shanahan cleaned house and started to set the Leafs on a new course. He hired Mike Babcock as the team's new head coach for the 2015-16 season. Babcock had previously been the bench boss of the Detroit Red Wings, taking them to a Stanley Cup win in 2008. He had also been at the helm for Canada's gold medal wins in the 2010 and 2014 Winter Olympics. Babcock signed an 8-year contract, making him the highest-paid coach in league history at that time. The Leafs appointed Lou Lamoriello as the club's new general manager after he served as GM with the Devils for 28 years, winning three cups in New Jersey. Also in July 2015, the Maple Leafs unloaded Phil Kessel, shipping him to Pittsburgh, where he has since won two Stanley Cups. The 2016-2017 season was a breakthrough run for the Leafs, as they drafted Austin Matthews first overall and put him right to work. Matthews led the team in scoring, starting with 4 goals in his first ever game and finishing with a total of 40 goals and 69 points in his rookie season, earning him the Calder Memorial Trophy as Rookie of the Year. He was joined by other young players, such as 2014 first-rounder William Nylander, 2015 first-rounder Mitch Marner, as well as veterans Nazem Kadri, Tyler Bozak, and Leo Komarov. The Leafs faced the Washington Capitals in the first round and threw quite a scare into the President's Trophy winners, taking a 2-1 series lead before eventually falling in six games. The future looks very bright for the Toronto Maple Leafs, with young stars like Matthews, Nylander, and Marner, along with the acquisition and signing of San Jose Sharks veteran Patrick Marleau. Leafs fans, who have endured 50 years of a Stanley Cup drought, hope to be finally repaid for their loyalty, which must rank as one of the most faithful and patient fan bases in professional sports.